Hello everyone, my name is Fahri Yardımcı and I'm working as a Site Reliability Engineer at Atlassian's OpsGenie product. Today, I will talk about distributed tracing using OpenTelemetry. Our talk agenda will first start with monitoring, then tracing and tracing concepts, then distributed tracing, and finally we talk about OpenTelemetry. So let's start with monitoring part. Monitoring is the important part of our lives. We are using a lot of tools, a lot of methods, and a lot of approaches to make it much more easier and helpful for us. So how can monitoring help us? Let's give us some example. We can use monitoring to ensure our application flows are worked as expected, such as we don't get any cache errors, any cloud provider errors, or any database failures, or we don't see any increased durations by checking our metrics or monitoring systems. We can configure our capacity planning because we have the historical data and we can say we have this amount of requests last 3 months, so we should consider increase or decrease to another instance type. And we can ensure our servers are in good condition, such as servers are not having any bottlenecks or network latencies or throttling. We can check this via checking and setting the correct alerts in our monitoring systems. We also see some of the implementation about this in the amazing talk from Kemal previously. With the introduction of microservices into our production systems and with the increased asynchronous flows, it makes it harder to identify problems. In monolith services, we may have dependency on 2 or 3 services. And now, as you can see in this graphic, service 1 has a dependency with service 5 and service 6. If something not right in the one of those services, this may affect our entire flow as well. So, how can we find out and identify the problem? Sometimes, just checking and seeing our application work as expected is not enough. Let's say customers reach us about that our application is slow or unresponsive. What should we do? By the way, this is a big problem for us because we need to find out this first instead of customers. So, question is simple. Can we identify the problems by just doing black box monitoring? So, let's think. When you are on call and you get paged at the middle of the night because one of the services returning too many 5xx alerts or latencies increased, what should we do? First of all, we need to identify the problem layer. Is it our login service or is it a database service? We narrow it down the problem scope. You might check our cloud provider. Maybe our availability zone is down or some service which we depend on is having an incident, such as load balancers could not forward requests or applications, or all database instances may having a hardware failures. Or maybe the entire flow is being problematic because one of the services is taking too much time for process request and causing intensive latency for entire flow. We can also use the log searching as well. We can search for the exceptions, errors, and we may find a help us to understand the issue. By the way, checking load is however, it's okay, but checking the unstructured logs is making the process very hard and identify the problems, it becomes much harder. With the developing technologies, we can add another option to previous slides, tracing. In this part, we are going to talk about tracing spans contexts. So what is tracing? Tracing provides insights into full flow of business logic using spans. So what is spans? Span is the primary building block of a distributed trace, represents an individual unit of work done in distributed system. Basically, it's the work which done by our functions or method or application. And it's the representative of the work happening inside our application with having a name, duration, and additional fields. And our applications may handle millions or billions of requests. And each of the requests may have a unique trace ID. And their child spans will share same period identifier. Because spans have their own identifier and names. Using this identifier, we can understand the parent-child relationship. And all the clients will add a timestamp, durations, and other fields into the span. So we will be able to understand request durations per services or operation statuses for each request. And we can easily see the request journey across our multi-service in production. So let's take a look at some example. In our first example, I created a basic scan with the OpenTracing library and Zipkin exporter. This output is from the Zipkin UI. As you can see, I used global tracing method to start a span. In this example, I give hello world name to my span as an operation name. We should always use understandable names, such as user edit profile endpoint request or order new coffee from machine endpoint, because we should be able to understand which work will be done in the span by looking its name. At least this will decrease our querying time. Next slide, we will see how those help us querying easier. Creating span is that simple with OpenTracing. Let's look at OpenTelemetry example. In our second example, I used OpenTelemetry, and for the exporter, I used logging exporter. Similar to OpenTracing, we got a name to our span, and as you can see the output, the span name is already there. And same with OpenTracing, creating basic span is simple enough. And we'll see some more fields in this output as well. We will talk about this in the upcoming slides. Also, we can see the trace identifier, span identifier, and time field, which we talked previous slides. As you can see, inside the span context object, there is our trace identifier and span identifier. So our span has additional information, such as tags, logs, attributes, events, status. Spans encapsulates these informations. And different clients, or SDKs for tracing, may support different field or different naming. We can add tags to our spans, and with these tags, grouping and querying them becomes much more easier, because we can search by the spans just by adding the tags and finding out the problems with the tags. It's much more easier. And we can use logs or events to record the helpful information with the timestamp. So let's say if the duration is longer than our limit, we can find out the root cause much easier when we get paged, because we have this insight information in the logs or attributes. Let's look at an example from the Zipkin UI. We can see the log with the operation log name, and we can see the value as an example value. Think of this adding an insightful information when something is wrong, and you find out and you search the trace and found the problem, and you have an external and you have extra information in your log. And for the tags, I added the tag with the name event and value GopherCon 2020. This will look exactly like this in the Zipkin output. In the OpenTelemetry example, we can set attributes using setAttribute method with given key, value, and types. Also, we can use event fields to use logs, similar to previous example. We can also see the timestamp in the message event field. Let's say we added a log inside, we added an event inside our trace, and our trace SDK will add a timestamp right now with our code. And in the OpenTelemetry, we also add the custom timestamp as well. So we talked about adding tags and setting operation names are important for both querying and analyzing the traces. When we try the search, we can give service name, minimum duration, and our tags. And with this, we narrow it down to results and easily find out the desired trace. Such as this example, I set service name go open tracing. I set tags with the URL pad, because I set the tag as a URL pad, I set the minimum duration. When I try to search something, and when I try to search minimum durations by just checking the tags, I can easily find out. So we talked in the beginning, how do we get notified from some latency before the customers, right? We can use this and create alerts. So we talked about handling millions of requests per second in previous slides. Sometimes we don't want to collect all traces, and sometimes it may become costly, and sometimes you want to collect entire of them. For these specific reasons, tracing SDKs provides sampling options, such as sample all requests, which will send all traces to our tracing backends. Or we can use probabilistic sampling. This sampler makes a random sampling decision with the probability of our defined value. Or we can use constant rate. We can say n number traces per second. And this way we can rate limits and maybe reduce the operational overhead to our tracing databases or our application. And we have a no operation sampling as well. Sometimes we don't want to sample some of our endpoints, such as our health check endpoint. Maybe load balancer send us a health check endpoint, and we don't want to sample of these requests. And therefore, we can use no operation and we can decrease the overhead by using this sampling. Span context. Span context help us move spans across work units. It can be between same class, different methods, or different packages, or even different service as well. When we look at the graphic, we can understand the parent span has took 8 seconds. When we check child span, we understand the parent span actually took 3 seconds, and the child span is having a 5 seconds of duration. And now we narrow it down the problem into the child span. And we can easily understand the problem by just narrow it down and simulate the problem scope. And with this information, we can identify the work unit durations and latency problems easily. And inject and extract fields. We can use inject extract methods to add headers or spans. This way, we can send our root and child span identifier to next services. That service does not need to use the same SDK or the same language at all. We will talk about this in the upcoming slides. So far, we have gained information about spans, span fields, tags, logs, and we created the example spans, and we look after sampling and span context. So question is coming. How to collect traces and link the spans between multiple services? We are going to use distributed tracing to answer this. So what is distributed tracing? Distributed tracing, or we can say distributed request tracing, is a method to use monitor or distribute application or microservices, because our microservices has increasing every day. And tracing in the same application may not be enough for us, and we need to see the entire flow across our microservices. And we can use distributed tracing to help us find out where the failures occur and what causes the poor performance. And we are going to talk distributed tracing in these three topics. These are multiple services, different languages, and inject and extract topics. Multiple services. Distributed tracing makes it easier to identify problem across multiple services. So let's take an example. In this example, we have two different services. We can say service 1 and service 2. I named them TalkDemo 1 and TalkDemo 2. By using distributed tracing with headers or tracing backends, we make the relationship with those services. Such as we can see the service 2 is called from service 1. And using the same HTTP request, which took 3 milliseconds. And TalkDemo 2 server is received this inside its recursive endpoint and give the span of this recursive endpoint field to understand which endpoint or what operation inside them. And seeing in this format makes it much more easier to understand the process and the request journey. So our next topic is different languages. We say we don't need to use same languages or same SDKs at all. We just need to send or trace and span identifiers to next service using correct propagations. So let's take an example and look at an example. In this example, we have three services: Node.js authentication service, Go checkout service, and Java shipment service. These are all three microservices, and they are doing different jobs from each other. And we can send, but we need to use same propagation between services, because these between services must understand the same propagation method. By the way, you don't need to use HTTP-based propagation at all. We can use gRPC-based propagation between those services. There is a good example in Google Cloud Platform GitHub account named Microservices Demo. I highly recommend to try this out for easy play and see tracing. If I'm not wrong, there were 11 services which you can easily play with the distributed tracing. Our next topic is injecting and extracting fields. In order to move span across services, we need to use same headers, and we need to use same propagation. So for injecting headers, I added the open tracing example. I use HTTP headers carrier, and we create our request with our business logic, according to our business logic. And we can use open tracing HTTP header carrier to create a carrier object, and we add our header inside that. After that, it's easy to call tracer and inject our current trace and span identifier. And it will be at the request headers. And rest, we just need to send the request to next service. It also supports gRPC as well. And the next service is need to extract from this trace and span identifier and create necessary spans and traces. And we just need to create a carrier object using received request headers. And after that, we need to extract span context from that. And if you don't get any errors in this process, we can create our spans using OpenTracing child of method. This method creates a span using the span and trace identifiers using the incoming headers. And how do we how the SDKs or these headers are specified? There are multi-trace propagation specifications. I will talk about two of them. Trace propagations defines the specifications sent or span and trace identifiers. And our SDKs and tracing tools must know these propagations in order to extract and use it. And Zipkin's B3 propagation format use x-b3 headers for passing the trace and span identifier to next service. And the next service has to understand this format in order to extract it. As we can see in this picture, we inject our request to our trace ID, parent span ID, and span identifier, and with the sampling decision, of course. And we're injecting our B3 propagation headers, which are the same as the trace identifier with have a prefix of x-b3. And after the our next service must have known how to handle these propagations and extract those identifier and sampled informations and continue to business logic. And our next trace propagation is created by Worldwide Web Consortium. And this is called by trace context. So we talked about there is a lot of trace propagation as well. And trace context propagation is implemented individually by each tracing vendor. And this, in the multi-vendor environment, this will create problems, such as traces that are collected by different tracing vendors maybe cannot be correlated because they will not share the same unique identifier. If we have used different vendors for different services, it may not be correlate each other. And our visual tracing may not be meaningful. And maybe some vendor-specific metadata might be dropped. Let's say you use SDK from another vendor, and your tracing backend does not know how to handle this fields or attributes, and it will drop this metadata, and you will lose some data. And some cloud platform vendors or some tracing SaaS cannot guarantee to support trace context propagation which you are using. And therefore, there is a trace context solution for this. Why do we need it right now? Because in the past, these problems may not have significant impact, as most applications were monitored by single tracing vendor and maybe stay inside only one cloud provider. And today, we have a lot of microservices, an increasing number of these applications, and causing some problems because we maybe use different cloud platforms, and these platforms may not support same propagation method. To overcome these problems, W3C consortium has proposed trace context. And there's already a lot of adapters, such as Elasticsearch APM, New Relic, OpenTelemetry, and Jaeger as well. So far, we see before the tracing, it's hard to identify some bottlenecks and some quick insights about production when incidents happen. Of course, we can add some reasonable monitoring metrics, and we can say we can add some per-service metrics or per-service durations as well. And if you don't use them, it becomes harder to identify the problem. And right now, we have a tracing option as well. With tracing, we can easily find out the problem, and we can stop incidents with the correct alerts using the traces. And also, I want to mention some of the tools. I want to mention Dapper. Dapper is a Google internal tracing tool, maybe the beginning of our tracing journeys as well. And there is a good book about this named Distributed Tracing in Practice. This is written by Dapper founders and developers. I highly recommend this book. It's a good beginner book, in my opinion. And also the Jaeger. Jaeger is created from inside the Uber, and it's highly used inside in the productions currently. So, or start of the show, OpenTelemetry. OpenTelemetry is actually not a new it's not a created from the scratch. And OpenTelemetry is a Cloud Native Computing Foundation sandbox project. We can say it's a new major release of OpenTracing and OpenCensus by merging OpenTracing and OpenCensus projects together. Currently, OpenTelemetry is in beta and is expected to become generally available in the second half of 2020. So which problems does OpenTelemetry resolve? Why not we use another tracing provider or another tracing SDKs? Why do we use OpenTelemetry? OpenTelemetry aims to resolve vendor locking problems. OpenTelemetry provides us a single set of APIs and libraries and agents or collectors to service to capture distributed trace and metrics from our applications. So we can use this single set of APIs to send them analyzed using Prometheus, Jaeger, or SaaS tools. And we said vendor lock will be happen if you choose some trace SDKs. And if you choose one of them, one of the vendor, if it becomes harder to change, because in the developing technologies, some things will change, such as you're using trace propagation maybe become deprecated, maybe it will not be supported. And in terms of these problems, and these problems will cause us a huge technical debt. And we can use some of the vendor agnostic tools to overcome this. So let's take OpenTelemetry and what OpenTelemetry provides us. OpenTelemetry has a lot of SDKs and libraries currently. There are Go, Java, Node.js, and Python SDKs. And we can find out this inside OpenTelemetry registry. There is a good tool in the registry which allows us to search for implementation libraries, implementations, utilities, or code examples for our desired coding languages. And there are a lot of issues in GitHub. Also, you can check it out and become a contributor for the OpenTelemetry, because we said it's already in beta and we can help it to become a general available. So we said OpenTelemetry provides us a metrics as well. OpenTelemetry is a metric instrumentation and defines three metric instruments that are intended to different purposes. These are counter, measure, and observer. Counter is a value that's summed over time. We can give an example of total ordered coffee number. Measure is the value that aggregated over time. We can give an example of ordered coffee number within a time range. An observer is a captured or the current set of values at a particular point of time. And unlike recurse tracing, the metrics are intended to provide statistical information to aggregate or application metrics. So there is a very exciting tool called OpenTelemetry Collector. OpenTelemetry Collector is a binary that receives telemetry data and optionally transform it and send to our defined exporter. It's a very exciting tool because you don't have to manage each of these exporters, configs, and different operations, not anymore. And it's a vendor agnostic tool. What I mean is you can implement your implementation of how to receive, process, and export is vendor agnostic. So you can easily use for each of your applications as well. And it's extensible. You can easily add another exporter or receiver by just change configuration. And we can also set our transforming configuration as well. And it has a one collector for different tools. It removes the need to run, operate, maintain of multiple agents, collectors. So we don't need to maintain our metric collector. We don't need to maintain our tracing collector. And in the future, we may not be need to maintain our logging collector as well. Logging will be added to edit to OpenTelemetry in near future, in my opinion. And using one collector, we can send this telemetry data to Jaeger, Prometheus, and or open source or commercial backends easily. So how the collector works? Collector needs to expect you to define a pipeline. A pipeline, it defines a path for the collector, starts from receiving, processing, or modifying, and sending data via exporters. And pipeline is received data from receivers. And we can use OpenSensitive receiver from this endpoint. We can use Jaeger receiver from this endpoint as well. And we have a processor. And we can say transform data or modificate the data using defined configurations. And we can use exporters to send our traces or backends. And we can use one receiver and multiple exporter as well. We can collect one trace data and we can export it to multiple tracing backends as well. Such as we can send one of our SaaS providers and maybe we can use one of the in-memory tracing backend for inside our production, maybe quick searching. And for pipeline, you can use only two types, traces and metrics. And for if you're going to use trace for the pipeline, you need to define three of the elements, receiver and processor and exporter. I will show an example next slide. And for the metrics, there is not there isn't available for receiver. For metrics, there isn't available processor right now, but it may be added in future. And for metric, you just need to define receiver and exporter, such as you can send your metrics to OpenTelemetry collector, and you can send exporter to Prometheus, and OpenTelemetry collector send your data to Prometheus without you to having any maintain your metric collector services as well. So we can configure all the collectors using this format. This is similar to Alert Manager or Prometheus format as well. We can define our receivers, such as we can say open census, and we can add another receiver, and we can give the endpoint of the inside this configuration. And for our pipelines, we can define for traces, receive from that receiver, and process, add something, or modify your data or trace, and export to Jaeger. Or you can use another pipeline to export it to another tracing backend as well. So, in the end of the slide, let's sum up what we talked until now. We can use trace to identify and find out problems in our systems. And with the distributed tracing, we can gain insights of entire services or entire application flows as well. And we see how can we add tags or logs to understand what's happening on applications and gain much more insights when something's happened. And we also learn different tracing propagations, such as B3 or W3C trace context. And of course, start of this show, OpenTelemetry, we see how we can use vendor agnostic tools to provide or collecting metrics and creating our traces easily. And with this, I'm finishing my talk. Thank you everyone for joining. And also thank you to the community team for arranging this event.